Welcome all to this final time slot. I have to unhook my microphone first, otherwise things will fall. And it's loose. Today I will be presenting you about SEO myths. I will first give a short presentation about who I am, then one sheet about what company I and my colleagues are running, and then a lot of sheets about SEO myths. I do not have a fancy clicky device, so I have to walk to my laptop every time. This is me on the sheet. My name is Theo van der Zee. I was born 4 December 1985 in the Netherlands. I have a master's degree in work and organizational psychology, over 10 years experience in web design, 3 years experience in SEO, and if you want to add me on Twitter, this is my hashtag. It's not even my hashtag, it's my Twitter name. I don't so into Twitter. What you see here is our website. It's finishjoomla.com. We did a full redesign in the past 2 weeks. We've spent a whole lot of time trying to optimize our conversions, trying to make it more intuitive to use. We just finished it like 3 days ago, so if anybody wants to comment on it after the session, I would be more than happy, exactly, to hear what you have to say. In the top right, you can see our latest template. It's called Avori, and we're really proud of it, up to number 4. But what you all came for are SEO myths. What we will be discussing today should be first a piece about PageRank, then I'll be discussing linking, suffixes that can be added to URLs, keywords, how to use them and how not to use them, and if you have enough time, I will be discussing whether to keep your page up to date at any time. Is that a ranking signal? Is it important? I don't know. Well, I do know. Why is it important in the first place to do SEO? You can be found anywhere, right? On Google, if you type in the right query, your page will pop up. According to this eye tracking study, which is marked by red lines that display screen sizes, so if somebody's screen is this size, they won't see the part below without scrolling. And on top, a red, orange, or yellow area marks a lot of views. These are tracked by an eye tracker that marks which points the eyes are looking at. Warmer colors mark more views. As you can see, the first two results get way more views than the results down there, especially below the fold. But views won't get you customers, right? Clicks are one step closer. As you can see here, the number one result on Google is getting over 3.5 times more clicks than the number two result, disregarding about what actually is in the description, in the title tag. It's 3.5 times more. If you go further down the graph, path to number 10, past the 10th result, only 10% of the people will actually see you. So if you're not on page 1 of Google for the keywords you're targeting, over 90% of your potential customers won't see your page. What are we going to do about that? Trying to help you unravel some myths that are going around in the SEO world, stating things like PageRank is a highly important metric. Should you be watching PageRank? What should you be doing about it? At the last Joomla days, I gave a similar presentation, and I've noticed that some people didn't know what PageRank was. That made this a pretty hard point to describe. So I decided to edit by far the most colorful sheet of my presentation, PageRank. I will try to give a short explanation based on this intuitive image about what PageRank is trying to be. PageRank is a ranking algorithm invented by Larry Page, the current CEO of Google, that is built to rank web pages. There are billions and billions of web pages on the internet, and only one is the most relevant for your search query. How to find which one? On the sheet behind me, arrows can be seen as links. The yellow one on the top left is getting a lot of arrows pointed at him. He's become big. He has a high page rank. But, as you might mention, how come the red one in the top right is also big? He has only one link. But that's coming from a really big other website. So that other website has gained so many trust by the search engines that only one link to the other page will make that one big as well and seen as important. But how important is PageRank really? Would you all please stand up? Everybody that does not know the PageRank of its homepage can sit down again. Everybody that does not know what PageRank its homepage has can sit down again. That leaves a whole lot of people. I hope my microphone can reach this. You, sir. May I ask your name?
Tony Davis.
Tony, what PageRank does your homepage have?
28.
28. That's a really high number. Given that's on the scale of 0 to 10. I had the exact same problem at the last Joomla days. I'll try to explain a little more, okay? Such moments. I pressed like the R button or whatever. Please, could you look? I'm sorry. Everybody can sit down again. And he has the sheets back up. I'm good. I just don't hit any other button than spacebar, I guess. What my next question would be was if anybody actually knew whether there was a correlation between the height of your page rank and the actual position in the search engines. What a correlation is. A correlation of zero means an event that has no effect at all on other event. If I flip a coin 50 times, the correlation between the number of times I've thrown it and the chance on heads or tails is zero. It's fully random. Every time I throw it again, it's a new random event. On the other hand, a perfect correlation. If I drop this piece of paper, I can give you 100% correlation that piece of paper will fall down and hit the ground. That's a correlation of one. Everything in between is between a perfect correlation and something that is fully random. As you can see, I marked it on the sheet. PageRank has a correlation to the position in the search engines of only 0.18. That's a really low correlation for something that 90% of the people actually have a number about what their page is ranking for. What else is wrong with PageRank? As you can see on this sheet, the PageRank updates are very irregular. Sometimes there's a PageRank update about 4 to 5 times a year, as you can see in 2008. But until January 2011, it had been over 13 months since the last PageRank update came. How to ever keep track of your changes, whether they are affecting your PageRank, when there isn't even an update? You can't see whether it has changed, whether you have improved your PageRank or decreased it. The numbers aren't even getting updated. In fact, Google has publicly stated that for some major websites, they are manually decreasing or increasing toolbar PageRank, as shown in your browser bar by this icon. This icon isn't even showing what it should be showing. Google is known to manually change this number. Further, it's really imprecise. If your website has a page rank of 4, it could be either a 4.1 or a 4.9. The toolbar does not show any difference between this. So even if the page rank updates were regular and you made a couple changes that made you climb from this point to that point, it would not be indicated at the toolbar. So once again, how to keep track of whether your changes are profitable or not? As you all have read, it's not actionable. My page rank has dropped. Now what? No one knows what to do. You can file a complaint at Google. Not sure if anyone has ever tried to write an email to Google. The chance at a reaction is not very high, especially on this case. What should we be tracking instead of PageRank? Because if you name a problem, they say you should name solutions as well. the number of customers. This could be tracked on a per day basis, on a per week basis, seasonal basis. When you know that a lot of customers are buying from you in the weekend, but they are buying from you in the daytime, are there differences in seasonality? Are there differences in the type of visitors that are coming on your website in the weekend? Maybe you can make improvements so that more people will buy in the week time that are influenced by factors that are now influencing people only in the weekend. Conversion rate. They say it's the holy grail of web design, no, of e-commerce. How many people are coming on your website and how many people are buying your product? That's something you can measure. That's something you can link to other factors such as new links you've acquired, new marketing campaigns you've launched. As soon as you know how many people are converting for a given day, you can make changes. It's actionable. You can do something about it. I'll skip the next one. Inlinking root domains. I've heard earlier today, I'm not sure by whom, somebody say that he had 35,000 inlinks. That's a really large number. But he didn't mention whether they were pages linking to them or websites linking to them. And that difference is enormous. When you're mentioned in the footer of a large website, it's easy to gain up to 1 million links to your website. Except for that only really counts as one, because there's only one domain that's linking to you. It is slightly more nuanced, but keeping track of the inlinking root domains, such as www.amazon.com, rather than all the subpages you're on, is a far more reliable number to track when you're trying to see if you're actually increasing or decreasing your SEO skills. Nah. Your position in the search engines. Keyword sending visitors to finalize this sheet. What keywords are actually converting your traffic? Is there a specific keyword such as Sony camera type ZX12? Or are people actually coming for Sony camera? Is there an optimization possibility if you add more specific product types to your database? Will more people convert? Once again, a number you can track and you can actually do something with rather than PageRank, which you can put on a poster above your bed, but it doesn't make a difference. Even Google says PageRank is not important. On the screen, you can see Google employee Susan Mosqua, who states that many site owners seem to think PageRank is the most important metric to track, which is simply not true. Google is telling us, stop looking at it. We have a nice number. We're using it internally. But the number we're showing is not actually something you should work with. You should see it, look at it, think, oh, that's cool, and move on. I really do need that sheet that marks the myth off. I'll just state it here. PageRank is not important anymore. It might have used to be. It is still a ranking factor. I've shown the correlation of 0.18 to the search engine position. It shouldn't be more than that. There shouldn't be discussions about, oh, wow, my PageRank increased. It's awesome. Great for you. But try to look at other metrics, actionable metrics that can actually gain your revenue or your conversions, something you can work with and better your life with, rather than looking at your PageRank blindly. The second myth, linking out to other websites is bad. There he is, our good friend Matt Cutts. Matt is the head of web spam at Google, and he should be seen as one of the largest gurus in the SEO realm, mainly because he actually knows how the algorithm works. That's a kind of an advantage, I'd say. Matt is stating, in the same way that Google trusts websites less when they link to spammy websites, a point I will be coming back to later, or bad neighborhoods, part of our system encourages links to good sites. I can see why this is so. If you type in a search query such as Bordeaux colored curtains and you land on a website but it's not exactly what you're looking for, wouldn't that website be worth more if it had a link to a description about these curtains? What color are they? Is this a color you can use in your monastery? If it hadn't had that link, that website would be of less value to you because you had to go back to Google, retype your query, and hope you can find something else. This is why I would see that Google values websites that actually put links to quality other websites, emphasis on quality, higher than websites that keep all the links to themselves. Why would you lock that visitor in if he wants to leave anyway? Give him a nice opportunity to move so he can actually go where he wants to go. I've mentioned earlier the bad neighborhood. What you can see on the screen is a picture made of Rio de Janeiro. On the left, you can see a nice villa neighborhood in the sun. And on the right, there's actually a cloudy neighborhood. I don't know how they got this picture, but it's really brilliant. Which is a bad neighborhood with poor people, tiny houses. You don't really want to be there. You'd rather be on the left. If you got seen too many times in the bad neighborhood, people might start thinking, hey, I'm not sure. He is in that neighborhood an awful lot. Maybe he's connected to it. Maybe he's got bad friends there. We don't want that. We don't want people connected to bad neighborhoods. I guess we should lower his value. That's not good. We want people from the left. Linking out to websites can be seen as the same principle. Linking into, by the way. An example of this. Spammy comments. On the screen, you'll see an analytics graph. Should just do it like this. An analytics graph that is showing the damaging results that spam comments can have on your rankings. In this case, on the number of visitors that came to a website. On the left, marked by the first balloon, was a large amount of spam comments left to pharmaceutical products, as they call it, on the blog of an SEO specialist. Ironically enough, he was attending a SEO conference to learn about how to optimize his website. At the point, the graph was down. He didn't look at his website, he didn't look at his statistics, until he discovered at the end that something was wrong. He came home, he was, what happened to my visitors? He went to the page and saw thousands upon thousands of spam comments, all linking out to rather doubtful websites, not the ones you want to link to. He removed the links. 2 days later, his traffic returned to normal. What this picture is stating is that you don't want to link out to just any page. If you got a comments feature on your website, try to protect it with a CAPTCHA, or try to make users log in before they can comment, so that there won't be enormous amounts of spam linking out to websites you don't want to be with. You don't want to be the guy who walks around in the neighborhood on the right. You want to be on the left. But we do want comments, because people can interact on our websites, they can talk about us, they can talk about the articles we publish. How do we do this? They invented rel is nofollow for this. Rel is nofollow is an attribute you can add to a link tag, as shown on the screen. The link is to joomla.org, which is invalid, by the way, because it's missing a double quote. Whatever. When you add rel is nofollow to that link, it won't count anymore. Famous SEO guru Rand Fishkin once described it as a link condom. You can safely link out to other people without leaking link juice, without being seen in the bad neighborhoods. It's like walking around with a big condom in the neighborhood and Google can't see it. And they think, okay, now that's good. You should be in that neighborhood for whatever reason, but you'd rather be not there. You can wear a rel is nofollow link condom. I really missed that sheet. So the sheet was linking out is bad for your rankings. This is not true. Linking out to good websites is actually good for your rankings, or at the very least, not harmful. Then again, linking out to bad websites is something you'd rather not do. As I've explained, the neighborhood thing, you don't really want to be there. But if you have to link out, try to use the rel is nofollow, as it doesn't harm your rankings anymore. By the way, if there are any questions, feel free to raise your hand. I'd answer them gladly. Trading links will increase your rankings. The traditional link exchange, or reciprocal link pattern, consists of a schedule such as shown on the sheet. Website A, which is us, links out to website B. Website B places a link on his website back to ours. I've heard tons of people talk about this as a great way to increase your links. It actually might have worked someday. I'm not sure about this. I don't think it works that well these days. There's actually data about how easy search engines can pick this up. They can actually see that he's linking to you and you're linking back. So, of course, they will decrease those links. Because if you otherwise, you'd just link out to half the internet. Half the internet would link back, nice and friendly. And Google would have lost its entire algorithm because everybody has a lot of links. The Black Hat spammers thought up solutions for this, such as the three-way link. Website A links to website B, B to C, C to A. That'll trick the search engines, right? Not anymore. But the amount of data that search engines have these days, they can simply pinch through this kind of schedules. I've even seen on the internet ring-like schedules with 20 of those points. It's still possible to phase them out. You can actually see that when you have enough data, clusters of websites that are interlinking. It doesn't work anymore. There's some value to it. I'm not saying you shouldn't link at all. In fact, in most industries, there is a lot of natural inlinking. When you write about SEO and you do it good, someone else writing about SEO is bound to link back sometime. That's a reciprocal link, but it isn't a problem. As long as you do it in small amounts, in a natural pattern, natural is an important word for search engines, in a natural pattern, Google wouldn't mind. As long as you don't start using schemes like this in large amounts, including link farms and God knows what, you're good here. The question was whether you can actually get penalized for using strategies like this. I don't have hard data on it, but I think that if you do it in large enough amounts, you actually might. That search engines have... Sorry?
So you might not get penalized, but the links ultimately become worthless. They pass no value at all. So it's effectively wasted effort, even if you're not fully penalized. Some people have in the recent update.
Yeah, the Panda update you're referring to, right?
Yeah.
Okay. But what if you want somebody to link with you? You get an email in your inbox, it's stating, oh my god, I want your link, link back to me, we can become friends. Might seem of value, might be a nice website. What to pay attention to when deciding whether you actually want this link? Most of these schemes send an email, please place a link to us on your homepage, and we'll find a way to link back to you. That link will probably be from some far off page, in hopes it will even be crawled by Google that far off, well, you are placing the link on your homepage, stating that you are trusting that other party, linking back from your most powerful page. You want to keep an eye on that. You want to know where they placed the link before you sign your deal or before you mail them back. Sure, we'll do this. Other factors. The enter text, as highlighted on the sheet. Enter text is one of the most important factors in ranking for a keyword on the search engines. You want that to be a great enter text. If you are developing Joomla templates like us, you don't want it to be chandelier or even worse, click here. Click here is in fact one of the worst keywords to try to rank on Google. It has such strong competition only by this pattern. Because of so many people linking with click here, it's in fact almost impossible to rank high on that term. That's miraculous. Those two factors are to keep in mind, and a third one that actually has a sheet is the visual location of where links are on the page. I'm aware of the fact that the left and the right bar have been reversed. It's not my image, but I should adjust it probably to avoid having to say this in presentations. What Google can do these days is actually determine what would be the visible location of an element on the page. They are doing this by deduction. If the crawler finds in your source code a division containing an ULI with a lot of links, one page named home and one page named contact, that should be the division containing the menu. Menus are usually top horizontal or on the left. The division containing a lot of content with a nice image in it and a call to action at the end, that will be probably the content division. We should assign extra value to it, because if you add links there, these links are only appearing once and probably related to the content the article is about. What this image is showing, I'll just turn around, is that link one placed in the content as determined by the search engines will give out most link value, while the link placed in the footer, which is probably not an important link, receives less link value. Google has deducted by seeing where on the page the link is, how much value they should attribute to it. So if you're trying to achieve a reciprocal link deal with another partner, try to ask them where they will place the link. Will it be some link hidden in the footer besides 500 other partners they might have acquired over the years? Or will it be a nice content link, maybe even in an article that actually describes what you're trying to sell? That was the final one again. Trading links will increase rankings. They might, as long as you keep it natural. Don't build any schemes on it. In fact, don't build any schemes at all. Google doesn't like them, except for when they do it themselves. Using a suffix will make your pages rank better. In the Joomla administrator, there's been an option. In fact, there still is an option. You can click on that says add a suffix to the URL. Should you do it? Suffixes are shown here, example.org/index.html. The .html is your suffix. Suffixes can be pretty much any shortening. I've pasted 5 on the sheet. Normally these days they would be each HTML, PHP, maybe even CGI or ASP. Matt Cutts has stated, is that next sheet? No, I didn't cheat that. There are only a couple suffixes you really do not want to use as your page suffix, such as DLL, as in the Windows binary file, .x, .sys. Those are server, no, those are system files, and you don't want Google thinking that your normal article that you want to have a nice suffix is actually a .x executable, because Google will simply either not crawl it or rank it far lower than what you might want it to be. I've heard, I've read about people stating that if it doesn't have a suffix, it doesn't look like a page. I've listed some big names. Even these guys are doing it. Amazon, one of the biggest converting websites in the world. Shouldn't they add a suffix? I mean, it's like a couple of minutes work adjusting your rewriting module, or in Joomla's case, simple case of clicking a button. If it were that easy, everybody would be doing it, right? There was a slight other piece I wanted to add here. The thing is, what I want to state, I'll just skip to the end. You don't want to add any suffix. It costs a lot of work, because when you're changing your suffix, you have to redirect all your pages. Rather than choosing not a suffix at all, doesn't require any work. That's what I wanted to say. The W3C web committee has stated that cool URIs don't change. When in 20 years we won't be using any PHP anymore, no more HTML, we can use these URLs. They are just fine. They're suffixless. So if the technology changes on which we are rendering our pages, we don't have to change our URIs. They stay intact. That's why I would advise you not to add any suffix to your URLs. That must be the easiest change I'm about to give you. Next myth. A regularly updated web page ranks higher. Higher for what? Higher for what keywords? Higher for what frequency? What I've shown here is an image of the long tail, which is a pretty complicated concept, but I think the sheet describes it pretty well. I shouldn't be standing there. On the top left in black, you'll see a one word phrase, shoes. Shoes is the term that the visitor of Google will type in hopes of finding nice shoes. This is marked as a very short tail keyword because it's only one word. Going down to the bottom left, men's shoes. This user has indicated interest only in men's shoes. This is still a pretty popular keyword because people don't like typing. They don't like typing a whole lot. When they see men's shoes, they type men's shoes. Some Google visitors are really simple people. On the other hand, there's the long tail marked with green. This user has indicated interest in red Nike men running shoes. That's very specific. If you have a web page about that, actually selling those red Nike men's running shoes, you have a pretty high chance of actually selling these shoes to this person, marked by the high probability of conversion. When this person landed on your page searching for shoes, there's a tiny chance he is actually looking for the red Nike running shoes you're selling on your page, rather than if it actually matches up to what you're offering. That's a really good connection. The searcher is actually finding what he's looking for. Compared to the high cost over there or the high competition, there are a whole lot of people trying to rank for those micro short keywords such as shoes because there's such an enormous volume for them. If you can get a number one for the term shoes, in fact, place one for for shoes, that's going to get you sales no matter what. No matter how small the conversion is, the volume is so immense that you actually make money out of it. What this marks is that it is an exclusive strategy. You can target both. For example, you could target a product page at men's shoes and write blogs about red Nike running shoes. You could link them back between each other and you will rank for both keywords. But does this actually get you higher in the search engines? I'm not sure how much time I have left. That's 13 minutes. And some Q&A. I'll make it. Does anybody want to share what they have done to get higher in the search engines by using a content strategy? It doesn't have to be your corporate secrets, just a general idea. What have you been doing to get higher up in search engines by writing articles, by syndicating your articles, by writing blogs? Is there anyone who wants to share that?
Mm-hmm. Back to your website or even specifically the product page. We found that works really well for getting a lot of people also not just finding out about your products but actually interested in it. It's a really good way.
Nice.
Links and actual visitors.
If I heard correctly what you're saying, that would be a long tail strategy where you're rewarding people for adding new user generated content. That does sound really nice. We'll get to the general Q&A at the end of the session because there's one more myth I'd like to bust here. Meta keywords tags boost your rankings. I think we got Matt Cuts upcoming. Yeah, he is. Google does not use the meta keyword tag in our web research. Raise your hands. How many people have actually spent time on the meta keywords tag for their current website? It's only 5? I had expected more. Still, it's too many. I know, which have a market share of about 7% in the Netherlands, but Bing/Yahoo, which is one search engine these days, by the way, for people wondering, they have stated to use it as a marginal signal and most likely not even for ranking pages, but more for classifying them. So yeah, it could be vital if you want to optimize, especially for MSN or Yahoo mix, but it's such a small market share, I don't think it's worth it, especially considering what my next sheet will be. A question in the back.
If you don't change it, then you have a lot of times your site with the name, and then as a description,
That's in fact the sheet after that. Oh, I'm sorry, it's the other way around. What you can see here is the place you enter, or rather do not enter your keywords. This is in fact pre-filled by Joomla. I'm not sure what it's in it. I think Joomla 1.5 content management system and Joomla, Joomla CMS. Empty it. That's both interesting and irritating.
That has happened to me before, so I tend to suggest clients just put a basic single keyword in there, just as a best practice.
Well, yeah, that would fit in with the strategy I'm about to describe next. Yeah, because what you can fill in the fields you just saw. This part is the meta title. It's your title tag. You can enter them in the global administration as your site name. Or you can customize them per page. That's a whole other presentation. I'd love to give that someday, but I don't think it'll fit in the 5 minutes I have left. The meta description, on the other hand, is what you type in the field shown at the top. It does not contribute to your ranking for a keyword. So if you mark it there like Joomla, 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 you wouldn't in fact rank at least the slightest bit higher for Joomla. The meta description is only used by search engines as a snippet to show under your entry in the search engine result page. What can we do with meta keywords, especially considering pretty much every competitor I've ever seen nicely fills them in. They present a great way to extract keywords from them, steal their keywords, and try to rank for them yourselves. These keywords are taken from two of our competitors. I'm not even sure which one they are, but they're big names. I like to know these keywords. Some of these keywords I hadn't tried to rank before for. I didn't know these were actually terms people were searching for. By simply going to the source of the web page and checking out the meta keywords, you just get free keywords. You can rank for them after or try to write articles specifically targeted for them. I've tried this out for customers in virtually every industry I know. They are still doing it. People are taking their time to actually enter this and giving away their free information. As you pointed out, if you just enter Joomla here, you would avoid the fact that Joomla will automatically override it. And there isn't much to steal about the keyword Joomla. I think most people will get that they should include it in their website about Joomla templates. Recapping, what did we learn? Stop obsessing over PageRank. It's a really nice number. You can actually view it. You can be proud if it goes up and sad if it goes down. Stop there. There's not much more to it. Try to get other ranking signals such as Moz Rank by SEO Moz. It's actually a nice changing number. You can track over time. It has multiple facets. It actually describes how they calculate the number. They show how it changes. If you want to track a number, try tracking that one instead of PageRank. Link out to quality websites and don't link out to bad neighborhoods. Not linking at all is not good. You don't want that. Google, in fact, encourages you to link to quality websites. Try doing so. If your visitor wants to leave, they will leave anyway. If you have to link to a bad neighborhood, try using the rel is nofollow I've described. You can simply add it to pretty much any A tag, as in link tag, and it won't attribute any link value anymore to the link you're giving. And in fact, telling Google, I'm not sure about this link. It might be there. Be cautious about it. Reciprocal links. Handle them with care. They aren't bad. They aren't something you should avoid. They are something you should do in natural volume. You can link out, link back. You can, in fact, email people, hey, do you want to be my partner? We can link exchange. Fine, but keep it to a natural number. Don't stuff your footer with like 45 reciprocal link partners. No one's buying that, especially not Google. They've seen it before. The suffix in your URL. Long story short, turn it off. That was easy. Add new quality content on a regular basis. By adding content, you can actually rank for longer tail keywords you can't possibly all target in your product pages. There's just so much text you can put on a page that still needs to convert visitors. If you write content articles about it, you can name it whatever you like. You can link back to your product pages, create a good internal linking structure. It can actually improve your website. I don't think it will actually make your website rank higher as a direct signal of updating it, but the other factors I've described earlier will make it rank better. Finally, stop entering meta keywords and start using them as a research tool. I mentioned this like 3 minutes ago. I'm sure you still remember what I said back then. Are there any questions?
What do you mean by a bad neighborhood? Is it how do they define a bad website? Is it like a blacklist, or is it defined by the page ranking? Or?
That's a really good question. It was asked, how are bad neighborhoods defined? I've recently read an article about it. It states, just look at it. If you are looking at a website stacked with AdSense ads, maybe even some kind of nice woman that is trying to lure you into buying her product, you can see it's bad. I don't think there's really a blacklist, at least not publicly stated, about which pages are good and which ones are bad. In fact, there will be a lot of gray in between them. Just do it on face value. If you see a site, you think, nah, you probably don't want to link them.
Are sandboxed sites like this, are they in bad neighborhood?
As in the sandbox you get to in by first entering Google, or the supplemental index you can get pushed into?
Market is a little bit dubious, and Google is not sure if you new sites get sandboxed.
I don't think that's particularly a bad neighborhood, especially not the new sites. I mean, Amazon had to have a first year as well. That's a great site. You want links from them, even in their first weeks while they were still in the sandbox. The supplemental ones, the ones that Google would mark as dubious, such as pharmaceutical, dating, gambling, you should be careful about getting links from them and to them. In the back. Semantic markup. Yeah, that is that one question I can't answer. I don't know. I should study that more to give a detailed answer. I can start guessing and trying to connect some in my head, but I don't think a good story would come out. I'd love to discuss it later. I knew you would do it. Yeah. Yeah. The question was whether linking out to sites outside your own realm could be marked as either bad or penalized. I doubt you ever be penalized for linking out to a quality website, no matter in what realm, whether yours or another one's will be a bad thing. I don't think they're a bad signal either. You're not doing anything wrong. You're maybe not doing the most natural thing, but you're not linking out to a website Google does not want in its index. You're just saying, okay, I'm a travel website, but I can tell you how to buy a great projector for when yours doesn't work, or a great laptop, in fact, nice example, when it doesn't match up to your projector. It is a natural thing to link outside your realm, even though it is not something you do a lot. Does that answer the question?
Or travel information or anything within that realm. So you are trying to do something else. And then maybe the I don't know, the active nobody knows the actual answer.
I wish I did. No, it could potentially be like that. I don't think it's a problem, for my personal opinion. I think that's a really great point, in fact, yeah. Micro summary, enter text is a really important factor in whether or not a link would seem legit or would be good. And nofollow is said by some sources to actually leak link juice, in which you are perfectly linking out with your condom, but there's a slight hole in it, so it doesn't really work. The question was whether legitimate hidden links, I presume, legitimate hidden links such as ones in sliders or tabs where you use display as none to not display a certain part of your page, but you choose to display it later, whether they affect your ranking. I don't think it marks a negative thing. You're trying to do something good. You're improving the user interface, which at the end, Google wants you to link to a page that you're trying to, where you can achieve your goal. If a slider improves your experience and makes you come closer to your goal, that's something Google would want. One more minute. That's something Google would want. By not displaying them, they can actually manually review your website and see, I see that's a display non-link. But that's not a problem, because he's trying to do something legit. And that's the most important thing. Think about your customers first and then about Google. The mega final question, or?
Yes, of course.
We're done.
Oh, yes, I have one question, actually. I'm quite a bit of a SEO guru, so.
Yeah, that's an interesting question.
So you should focus on getting on the high page, because otherwise you don't get visitors from the other end.
Yeah, I know what you mean. The question was whether I first described as it's best to get high up in the search engines because you get noticed, you get clicks, and you get people on your website. And later on I described how conversion is a far more important metric than anything else. They're actually linked. If you can get your SEO right for a certain page, whether that's a long tail page such as Red Nike men's running shoes from season 2011, or Nike shoes. The Nike shoes one is far tougher to get high on, and the other one is easier. That means that if you actually get place 5 on Nike shoes, you get more visitors, but they are more unlikely to convert. On the longer tail keywords, it sounds way better in my head. You need both. You both need to rank somewhere, and your website actually needs to be optimized for users as well to convert. That's a way better explanation than the one I was going to. You need both. In the back. Well, one more thing, I forgot it last time, I've learned actually. We sell templates. If you're interested in them, you can use this coupon code to get 20% off for the next 2 weeks, 50 coupons available. Write it down if you think you might be interested. On the right, you can follow Finnish Joomla, our company, on Twitter, or at TheoVDZ to follow me on Twitter. Thank you all for visiting, and have a great trip home. Thank you.